We'll try to make this panel as conversational as possible and having the participation of you all, so please, we'll try to be quick so that you all can participate, because that was the original idea. I'll just start by saying, well, my name is Celina from the ITS, the Institute of Technology and Society in Rio. Me and Mario, we will be, he's also from ITS, we will be moderating and participating, and I'll ask you, each of you, to present yourselves briefly once you guys speak. So I'll just like to start by saying that, so from Brazil, I think it's been interesting to set like the context, overview of how the right to be forgotten is seen and is being dealt with in Brazil. And I'll ask them to share their perspectives from their own countries and their research. And the context that we live in Brazil, it's years after having been under a military dictatorship. So all we talk about is right of truth, right of memory, and having our freedom of expression back in place, having for years been suppressed. So in this democratic context, I would say that we favor freedom of expression, access to information, rather than right to be forgotten. So actually, just to set this as an example, our Internet Bill of Rights, which actually there's a book here, this purple one that you guys can have. It talks about, in English, about our Internet Bill of Rights, and the article that says about Internet intermediary liability is based on freedom of expression. So Internet intermediaries can only be liable if they don't obey a court order ordering a removal. And the article is framed defending and sustaining freedom of expression. So it's a very different, I would say, framework than what we've seen in the discussion, especially here in Europe. And so just to set that, freedom of expression is seen also as a right to exercise other rights, such as education, of culture, research. So it's something that we are very keen on having and fomenting. And we did a research on six different state courts in 2016. And we found out there were like 114 cases that mentioned right to be forgotten. And the outcome was that it was almost half and half, in 41% of the cases that the judge ordered a removal of content. But in a majority, but not that big difference, the public interest and access to information argument won. I will Mario will talk about, there are two pending cases. There's the pending case about right to be forgotten in the Supreme Court, and another case on the Superior Court that was already decided. But this is just to see, these cases I mentioned was on lower courts. And actually one of these cases involved a plea by former military that wanted to have his participation on the military dictatorship being erased. And he did this claim under the amnesty law. And the court actually allowed it and said it was, yeah, that the amnesty law should also be applied under this context of right to be forgotten. And actually, I think this is very wrong, because the amnesty law, in thinking about the context, was based to influence the lack of criminal responsibility and not involving a right to be forgotten, let's say, because if that would be the case, it wouldn't make no sense to have all the truth commissions that were set up around the region, because if you just say that you can have the amnesty law could erase the past, it just it just doesn't make sense and it's out of context. But this was just one isolated case. I hope, I don't think this will continue. Unless some of these, we have just the final point, some bill of laws that are being presented by politicians to include expressly the right to be forgotten, because they are the ones that actually, according to Google Transparency Report, are the ones who are ranking first on the removals requests. And I wouldn't say that it's because they're very concerned with privacy. Actually, they're just wanting to hide all their wrongdoing. So if one of these kind of laws get passed, we wouldn't be able to, like, all the history of our politicians would be not, what won't be online. So I don't think it, I'll let you guys know if we will need some international pressure not to make this go through. I don't think there is a political momentum for this to go. But so now I'll just pass to Mario to talk about these cases on the Supreme Court, and which we are filing also an amicus.
Yeah, I'll try to be quite brief. It's just, I think the first point that we have to talk about Brazil is that the way the right to be forgotten was shaped by the higher courts, it's more as a right in terms of content and not a right to the list as the Google spam case. So in Brazil, we had a case dealing with the listing of links years before the Google spam case. So we had a case, I think, in 2012 dealing with a celebrity in Brazil. She was trying to list because she has a TV show for children, but in the past she was involved in a movie where she was supposed to have some intimate relations with a child. And then she tried to, let's say, to erase this. She managed to let's say, to buy and to block the selling of this VHS, but for the web, it's still there. And when you put her name on the search engine, it always links to different links dealing with parts of this movie. So she tried to challenge it, Google and courts. The case arrived to the Superior Court of Justice, which is the highest appellate body for federal law in Brazil. And the court said that that such a right didn't exist in Brazilian law. So and I think the court went a bit further. It was before the ECJ case, and the ECJ case had a lot of impact on the international fora. But anyway, the court said that even if the search links to illegal material, even in that case, there wouldn't be a right to the list that links. So in respect of freedom of expression, access to information, and so on. But then after the Google spam case, we had two cases jointly decided by the Superior Court of Justice, dealing again with the right to be forgotten, but in a different way, much more in terms of content. It was, those cases were more related to the first German case on the right to be forgotten. The first one dealt with someone that was acquitted from the convictions of a specific crime, a massacre we had in Brazil in the 90s. The main broadcaster in Brazil, they decided they had a TV show to revisit some old cold cases. So they decided to broadcast again the TV show based on this specific case. And they seek authorization from this guy, and the guy denied. But then, even like this, they decided to broadcast the show. There was a huge impact in the life of this person, so he suffered many threats and so on. So he brought a case, and the case arrived in the Court of Justice, and the Court of Justice mainly seeking damage from the broadcast and try to prevent further, let's say, broadcasting of this specific show. And the court said that in that case, there would be a right to be forgotten, but in terms of the content, not in terms of leaking, because it didn't deal with any such engines. It was an offline issue. And the court said that because the guy using his name or mentioning his name was not necessary for telling the story. So it was not necessary for contextualizing the whole crime because he was not one of the main actors in that case. In the same day, there was another case, this in a kind of a joint decision for the court, dealing with another criminal case with the same broadcaster. And in that case, the court said that there was no right to be forgotten. And the argument was exactly the opposite, saying that the person in that case, the ones seeking damage were the relatives of the victim of the crime. And then they said that she would be the main actor of that case, so using her name and showing her pictures would be fundamental for telling that story and for informing the public. So in that case, they decided that there wouldn't be a right to be forgotten, so the freedom of expression and right to information were prevailing over privacy in that case. And then that's the case that's pending the Supreme Court. But the Supreme Court in Brazil, in many different cases, has said that freedom of expression, as Celina just mentioned, has a preferential role over other fundamental rights because of our past of dictatorship. And I think it's more or less the same thing as in other Latin American countries. So we have this different context, but still, we are not dealing with the right to be forgotten in the same way as in Europe, because it's not the listing, it's really the content, which is something that I would say that's, it's not so strong as just going through the searching genes, because in that case, still the content will be in somewhere, so we are not, let's say, excluding the content, we are only making more difficult to find the content, but the content will still be there. So that's the current scenario we have. We still have some bills of law, but I think the Supreme Court, from its jurisprudence, it seems to be that the court will take the same approach, having freedom of expression prevailing over privacy. But we never know. We are facing a different, some of a kind of change in the composition of the court with new justices coming, so let's see how they will deal with that, especially because the ones that are coming now, they have close ties with some politicians, and those are the main ones that want to delist links from the web. So let's see what we have. Maybe there will be a slight change in the decision. And we are still, presenting a brief in that case, so against the idea of the right to be forgotten in that specific case. I think maybe I can pass to Javier to give a general overview, and then all the others can comment on.
Okay, yes. Well, my name is Javier Palero. I work for Access Now in Latin America as a policy analyst. And yeah, probably just to add to what the guys at ITS, Celina and Mario, were saying, we can see that it's very interesting to study the differences in which we understand, what we understand as the right to be forgotten and how it is changing in different regions. As you know, the Costeja case here in Europe has a very specific reach. It has a very specific solution for a very specific claim and for the prejudicial matters that were raised to the court. But what we are seeing as very worrying is this trend in Latin American countries which have been having solutions for these things from different institutions to now adopt this language of the so-called right to be forgotten. What I mean by this is that, for instance, if you try to do some academic research about this issue and start using the internet, for instance, to search for right to be forgotten cases, you will see that there are mentions of so-called right to be forgotten cases in places like Argentina, like Mexico, like Chile, for instance, but those cases are not related even to data protection. These are things that are, as Mario mentioned, previous iterations of situations of delisting a person from Google searches or Yahoo searches, or some person trying to exercise rights to protect their image, self-image, honor, etc. And many people, I think that not innocently, are calling this right to be forgotten when this is a very different approach based on personal rights. But the interesting thing is that the main problem that we have with the protection of honor versus the freedom of speech and the freedom of information, that same tension that you may perceive sometimes, you know, where publicness ends and when the protection of one's personality begins, it's also seen in data protection. So we still have this little fight over the limits of things. And something interesting to see is that the main lobby in Latin America that I've seen in my case, for instance, and it's clear in Mexico, we have Mexican participants here who can probably weigh in later, is that there is a big interest in some private sector, especially legal services, you know, in order to create really rapid mechanisms, you know, to take down content and to collect very interesting fees from people interested not only in protecting from themselves from discrimination or protecting themselves from just the information that can be negative about themselves, but also just to make up, you know, their own image on the internet, you know, to try to be better suited for a future candidacy as a politician or stuff like that. So it's very interesting to see this evolution and this change, which that goes from a very specific right to be disassociated from certain search terms, which happened in Europe, until this very broad and vague definition around personality rights and stuff like that. And now some people are not innocently calling everything the right to be forgotten.
Hi, I'm Daphne Keller. I'm from the Stanford Center for Internet and Society. I direct intermediary liability work there. And previous to that, I was the Associate General Counsel for Intermediary Liability at Google. And I was in that job when the Costeja ruling came down, so I got a front row seat on the European right to be delisted through a lens of intermediary liability law, which I think is a very different perspective on the question than you have if your background is in data protection law. The framework, the legal categories, how you step through the problem in black letter law is very different under data protection law versus under conventional intermediary liability law. And I actually have a new paper out focused on Europe and how that collision is sort of proceeding before our eyes in slow motion, the collision between how notice and takedown works under the e-commerce directive and how it may work very, very differently, and not just for Google, under data protection law. So I have done a fair amount of work focused on Latin America in the past year or so, and also I have had my students do a bunch of work, so I am free writing on some of their research. If you're out there watching this, thank you, you guys. And a thing that has really stood out, both in my research and in the things that they dug up, is the difference in the human rights frameworks between Europe and Latin America. And I don't mean that just in a fuzzy aspirational way. I mean that in a way that matters for litigation, because there are differences in the human rights frameworks that drive the way that statutes get interpreted. And specifically, in Europe, under the Charter for the European Union, it's the only major human rights instrument that expressly has a data protection right that is separate to and additional to the privacy right. And this is something that the Court of Justice in Costeja referred to explicitly, saying we're interpreting the language of the Data Protection Directive in light of this fundamental right. And in light of that, we conclude that Google is a controller. Google needs to carry out notice and delisting for claims from individuals. Now, but by contrast to this relatively strong focus on data protection in Europe, which, by the way, the court said would, as a general rule, trump the information rights of internet users who might want to find that information. By contrast to that, in Latin America, or throughout the inter-American human rights system, that's a system that has expressly identified itself as having the strongest free expression and information protections of any of the regional human rights systems. And that informs statutory interpretation within that system. Catalino Botero, the former special rapporteur for free expression in the Inter-American system, has said, conclusions reached under other international human rights instruments cannot be mapped directly to the Inter-American system because of the unique emphasis that we place on free expression. So what does that mean in real litigation or in real legislative battles of the kind that people on this panel have been carrying out? I think for the so-called right to be forgotten, it means a lot, because the statutory language or the directive language that was interpreted in Costeja, the Google Spain case, is replicated almost verbatim in the laws of a lot of Latin American countries. The Argentine data protection law I believe is verbatim a copy of Spain's implementation.
Yeah. Like the,
yeah, so no changes at all. So when courts in that region look at claims that are trying to press the exact same interpretation that the CJEU reached in the European case, do they have to reach the conclusion that the CJEU did? Do they have to follow that court because the court has already told them what this law means? I think the answer is no. And, you know, I think there are a range of interpretations they could reach, but I do think it's really important, just as a starting point, to recognize this is a law that is susceptible to many different interpretations. Even in Europe, during the course of the Google Spain litigation, the CJEU's own advocate general, who's this very influential court advisor and whose opinions are usually more often than not followed by the court, he said Google's not a controller. He said there's no right to be forgotten under the Data Protection Directive. And then the court disagreed. The court said Google is a controller, there is a right to be forgotten. But that in itself sort of demonstrates this is an ambiguous law. This can be read a number of ways. And if you start with an ambiguous law, and then you have an overlay of these different fundamental rights frameworks that color the interpretations courts reach, I think you can come to some very different outcomes in Latin America. And indeed, I think we're seeing examples of that. So in the recent Mexican case, there was a Mexican case that it was a data protection case that did go through the Mexican DPA. The Mexican DPA ordered Google to delist information about a man from a powerful trucking and shipping family. And it went to the Mexican courts, and the Mexican Court of Appeal said, this delisting order is invalid and must be reversed. And the reason it must be reversed is because the publisher, the magazine whose webpage it was, never got notice and never got an opportunity to defend its free expression interest in this case. So that is a procedural problem. That's a violation of the expression rights of the magazine. Reversed, remanded, go back and think about this again. By contrast, in Spain, as those of you who follow the news know, the Spanish DPA just fined Google 150,000 euros for telling the webmasters about delistings under Costeja. So even if you just look at those procedural rights, there's this striking difference emerging between what happened in Mexico, which is you have to tell the publisher and let the publisher defend its online expression, versus what's happening in Spain, which is you may not tell the publisher that is not appropriate under data protection law. So I could go on more, but I think we should find out from KS what is going on in his region and beyond.
My region. well, so I have to cover Asia. well, I'll start with my own country, Korea. Well, Korea, if there is a proponent of right to be forgotten in Korea, he would not need the right to be forgotten because Korea already has had truth defamation, where you can be held liable criminally and civilly for disclosing truth that lowers the reputation of another person. So, for instance, a worker complaining aloud about non-payment of his wages by his employer was criminally indicted and was convicted of defamation. There is a defense of public interest to truth defamation, but the defense is worded like you have to disclose truth solely for public interest. So the worker who complained about non-payment of wages, he complained aloud with a little bit of private interest in getting his wages paid, so it didn't satisfy the solely for public interest requirement. And you can see how oppressive it can be for freedom of speech. A senior an elderly who complained online about a beating that he took from an officer of an elderly association was also prosecuted and found guilty of truth defamation. This happened only 2 years ago. I'm not talking about, you know, many years ago. I'm talking about the current trend right now. So truth defamation is already, truth defamation serves all these desires of people who want to protect their reputation. And, you know, so Right to be Forgotten, Right to be Forgotten doesn't provide criminal liability for people, you know, disseminating information. And Right to be Forgotten does not go to the source of the source of the material. It only suppresses circulation of the material through one specific media, the internet. And truth defamation goes further than that in terms of the strength of the remedy. So that's why there is not much a push from the powerful elite to adopt Right to be Forgotten. Unlike Indonesia, where the powerful elite successfully passed a Right to be Forgotten law, which follows almost almost exact language of the ECJ decision. So a person can seek a court order removing information that is quote-unquote, you know, no longer relevant. That has been heavily criticized by free speech advocates in Indonesia. And that exchange between the civil society and the new Indonesian law, which will take effect, by the way, I think in 2018, right? That exchange between the government, the elite-led government and the civil society kind of shows where Asia is in its posture with respect to Right to be Forgotten. There are so many impunities that have to be addressed that originate from the colonial period or authoritarian dictatorship period that many Asian countries just came out or that are still struggling with. And having one more jurisprudence allowing suppression of truth as insult to the injury of having actually having inherited the truth defamation law from the books of European criminal laws. Now, international law on truth defamation is clear. Human Rights Committee, UN Human Rights Committee issued back in 2010 General Comment 34 on freedom of expression and has a long paragraph about defamation and clearly said truth shall be a defense to defamation, especially any form of criminal defamation. It's not a qualified defense. It has to be an absolute defense. I tested that when Korea came up for review by Human Rights Committee in 2015. We went to Human Rights Committee with our truth defamation law, and the Human Rights Committee issued a specific recommendation that truth shall be a defense without any qualification, without any requirement that it be associated with the public interest or solely for public interest. So from the Korean perspective, rightly forgotten only strengthens the curtain of silence, the curtain of cartel that has suppressed sharing of information that's needed to address corruption and other you know, important social issues. Now, some proponents of Right to be Forgotten argue that will defend Right to be Forgotten by saying that it does not apply to public figures or does not apply to matters of public interest. But a lot of times, without that information that was just taken down from search results, you'll never know whether something is a matter of public interest or not. And you'll never know whether a certain person is a public figure or not if the full information is no longer available because of the manipulated search results. Through this presentation, I'm kind of reflecting the discussion, debate that's going on about Right to be Forgotten in Korea. The end result is that Korea, I don't think, will follow the footsteps of Indonesia. There is so much anger in the public about any additional jurisprudence that may justify sharing of information that will be vital for their safety, democracy, open market. There's one other country that I should cover, India. There were three cases out of Indian high courts. India has a federal system, so each state has a high court, that worked on the availability of court judgments on internet and the online registry. And there were some conflicting decisions. Two courts issued in favor of removing from the registry and online. One court ruled against it. And then there is an important Delhi High Court that has not made a decision. The hearing is taking place in April that we should watch with care. Right to be Forgotten, I don't know whether we should take that as a jurisprudence directly applicable to a right to be forgotten, because there we are talking more about whether the court itself issuing judgments on sensitive cases involving matrimonial disputes or sexual abuses should allow the names to be even mentioned in the court judgments. Because in these cases, the former parties in those criminal cases, having lost the opportunity to petition the court to erase the names, go back to the same court or higher court or different court to remove their names from the judgments of the prior proceedings. I think this is a little bit different from Right to be Forgotten, because this is more about kind of lost opportunity for protective orders that should have been issued on a case-by-case basis. No opponent of Right to be Forgotten will disagree with courts, issuing protective orders on specific cases on a case-by-case basis when there's high likelihood of discrimination that can be triggered by having the names of the parties available to the public, especially considering the different cultural uniqueness of the region.
brief comments on what Park said and Daphne. I think we have, in terms of defamation laws, I think it's a problem everywhere. It's not a specific South Korean or Asian issue. Even in Europe, I think most European member states have defamation as a criminal offense in their laws. So that's the case of Belgium, for instance. So if you see most EU and Council of Europe member states, they still have a defamation as a criminal offense. And I can go even a step further. Even blasphemy laws, they're still in place in Europe. So you see people talking about religion, being convicted. So there is a clear risk for restriction of freedom of expression and so on. I'm also, I think I forgot to highlight that in the Brazilian case, we don't have a data protection law, so it's something that also counts in our favor in that sense, but still, we are not against the data protection law, so we've been discussing data protection law for many years, so it's still pending in the parliament, and maybe by the end of this year, we'll have some news. Let's see if the political landscape will help. But I think a good thing to comment on the right to be forgotten and then in the Corteja case, I think Daphne is the right person to comment on that, is that I think the court in that case went a bit further than what the parties were discussing, because they were not asking the court to just say that Google should be the one to decide and that the request should be addressed straight to Google. So if I'm not mistaken, I think all the, even Corteja and the Data Protection Authority in Spain, they were requesting that an authority, what would be an administrative or a judicial authority, would be the one to decide and to balance on a case by case which request should be accepted or not. So it was not to send to Google and then without any possibility of balancing the rights involved. Because as Daphne has highlight in the Google case, you don't have the possibility for the other part to challenge the decision of excluding the content. So there is no, let's say, due process in analyzing the requests of the listing. So someone presents a request, and most of the time, no one will know that this request was accepted by Google. So only the one that requested the listing. So. And the only one to challenge will be the one that requests and had the request denied, and then we'll be able to challenge. But the website that is publishing the information had this link in the list of queries of search queries by Google will not know that this case was there, so that there was a request and that the information was excluded. So there is a clear, let's say, restriction of due process and so on. I think it's also an important issue. And of course, we're also discussing, and one of the things that we are, let's say, a bit against is the idea of having a private player balancing the right to privacy and freedom of expression, that specific. It's not that we are against in some specific situation, someone that really has a case of defamation, has a real problem, or there is another legal base for that, but maybe the data protection wouldn't be the right, let's say, legal basis for the leasing, and especially on a private way, on a private basis. I don't know if anyone else wants to come, maybe Daphne?
Yeah, so I think To echo what Javier and KS have said, some things about the so-called right to be forgotten are not new. There has always been notice and takedown from search engines or notice and delisting. There have always been claims in many countries around the world that are based on privacy or based on a right to honor or based on a right to dignity. And in some countries of the world, notably in Brazil, you need a court order for that. It has to go through a genuine public adjudication process, and you don't just hand it off to an American technology company to decide what the law says. But in many other countries in the world, including all of the EU, you don't necessarily need a court order. And so there are people just going to Google or going to Facebook and saying, hey, this is defamatory, take it down. And the companies have to decide whether to take it down or not, and if they don't, they risk liability themselves. These claims, these long-standing claims, aren't in the company's transparency reports for sort of dumb historical reasons. And they don't get much attention. I think people tend to think there's nothing out there except copyright, right to be forgotten, and government requests. But there's this very real universe of notice and takedown based on the same kinds of rights that are conceptually that are at issue in the so-called right to be forgotten. What's different under Corteja First of all, is, as you said, that it absolutely put it on the search engine to make the assessment. Secondly, that it did so under a new vague standard that nobody had ever heard of before, this sort of, well, you balance inadequate and irrelevant and excessive, these sort of data protection words, against public interest. And this is something that doesn't have a longstanding body of court assessment or litigation or standards from human rights bodies telling you what it means. So it takes this newly defined and vaguely defined right, and it hands it to a private actor to resolve in secret, and it doesn't give the accused speaker any mechanism for review. So the things that are new are, in a way, much more procedural, but they are procedural changes that lead to an incredible shift in the substantive outcomes. And in Europe, one of the problems with it is that the requests to delist or erase content under a data protection claim are not necessarily covered by the e-commerce directive. So all of the precedent in European countries about what the rules are for notice and takedown under that directive can potentially just get thrown out the window for right to be forgotten. And so, for example, the e-commerce directive says that a country can't compel intermediaries to generally monitor their users' communications. You can't force them to go out and proactively police everything that their users do. Well, if that doesn't apply to right to be forgotten claims, suddenly the whole debate about monitoring and filtering comes to bear on this massive category of new claims. So there's a lot of mess that arises from rooting it in data protection law, and that does make it different from what came before.
Yes, sorry. a short intervention just to add to what you just said. So this trend that you just indicated as dangerous, which is the privatization of this kind of administration of the truth on the internet, which said in these terms sounds terrible, which is because it is terrible. There's also another problem that we have seen in Latin America, which is this. At least in Argentina, I sadly can't speak about other countries very specifically, but probably members of the audience who are from other Latin American countries can complete this information. At least in Argentina, the DPAs, historically, they have almost never used the mechanism of suppression of information. Most of the times, they just use a notice, or they use a fine, if it applies, you know, for cases where the data protection laws, which are copied, as you said, verbatim from the Spain data protection law. The way in which they enforce the law is by, a notification, a warning, a fine, whatever. But it's very rare that the solution is the suppression of the information. And right now, everyone is talking about, oh, I have this capacity as a DPA, an administrative body, you know, to go and ask a controller of information to just erase information, you know. So this is where the advantage of what KS said on the defamation law get evident, because in defamation law you need to have a judicial process, and as you said, and it's not only in Brazil, it's the standard for the Inter-American system is the judicial decision to the takedown of information, period, because you need to have a bilateral process where you can have defense and a lot of defenses, not only publicness or public interest defense, a lot of defenses. And the other thing is that I think that this trend appears because a lot of people will say, oh, but the internet is so fast that we can't wait for a judicial decision. And this is true because in some places, especially in Latin America, judicial decisions can take years, literally years. And appeals and things, you know, never end. So probably the solution is more a procedural solution within the framework of judicial systems that can make probably the case for faster actions, subpoenas that probably put like a temporary solution for things and then have the discussion. But the thing is that the discussion needs to be happening. You know, it's not, we really should be aware of the solutions that don't include a discussion about what is the characteristic of an information that, again, is a lot of times truthful information. Remember that this is truthful information, right? And in other cases where that is contested, the line to draw is not always very clear.
Someone want to comment? I was maybe just trying to see if someone in the audience wants to jump in and add to what we were discussing.
Hi, I'm Luis Garcia from R3D from Mexico. I'm glad you mentioned a lot of the cases that we worked on in Mexico, but I just wanted to add a couple, make a question and add a comment, because I think what Daphne mentioned is very important about the differences between systems and how we cannot understand that the outcomes can be even the same in different regions, and I would say even intra-regionally. In inter-American system, for example, in Mexico, the way censorship is interpreted by the Supreme Court is very, basically says anything that, any measure that doesn't make available, that removes the availability of information, it's censorship, and it's almost always unconstitutional. Which it might be an even extreme interpretation of an already very extreme position in favor of freedom of expression in the American Convention. But what I want to ask is whether we should abandon the idea. I mean, I have abandoned it, but I think we should make it more broad, this assumption that there cannot be a global harmonization on this, and that there is no perfect outcome as well. that we shouldn't strive for a perfect solution because there isn't. If you allow for censorship, you will get cases in which you censor information that shouldn't be censored. And when you don't allow a censorship, you will have cases in which the material effects of an expression will materialize in very awful ways. And you will always, in an argument, be able to point out that those cases and try to throw it at the other person. But I think we're not getting anywhere because it's easier for each position from Europe, from the American system, to look at and show how cases of corruption are being censored or how a poor person has been damaged in her reputation and her life for the materialization of expression. And maybe we should just accept that there's no perfect solution anywhere, and that we shouldn't be imposing our solution in the other side. And that goes to my question part of my comment, which is, how can we reconcile this with the idea of global removals and this almost colonial assumption that an authority in one country can decide on what everyone else in the world should find in a search engine?
Well, let me take a step at global harmony. The Senate, the U.S. Senate and the House of Representatives just last week abolished the FCC order, privacy order that was issued to network operators. That privacy order was one example of sector-specific data protection law just for telecommunication industry. You know, the U.S. doesn't have a general comprehensive data protection law, but has a data protection law for health information, and has data protection law video rental information. I don't know why. Maybe that's as sensitive as health information. And then now we were going to have data protection law for, you know, web browsing history. And whatever the information, the communication metadata that the users give, make disclosure to the telecommunication industry. Their ISPs. Now, this abolition of this data protection law, I think, is very significant in removing the possibility of reaching some sort of middle ground between the U.S. approach and European approach. Because A lot of people in the US were dissatisfied with the third party doctrine, which ruled that if you make if you make disclosure to some part of the public, then you will be deemed to have lost privacy interest in that information, so that that information is can be freely disseminated among the rest of the public without any consequences. A lot of information that we thought should have been protected under privacy were left outside, were left vulnerable by wiretapping laws and other surveillance laws. So, for instance, there is this incomprehensible rule that information stored for over 180 days can be accessed by law enforcement without warrant. So that all originates from this third-party doctrine that if you leave some information open to observation by some third parties or some part of the public, then it's a fair game for the other part of the public to process the same data. Now, European approach, I think, went the other extreme by using data protection law to protect privacy. I'm saying the other extreme because data protection law applies to all data, regardless how data has been kept by the data subject. Even to the data that has been made publicly available voluntarily by the data subject are still under the purview of data protection law. So there has to be some line drawing. There has to be, I think we should jettison, we should throw away the third-party doctrine. I think that even if you make phone calls through a telecommunication operator, there is a confidentiality between the operator and you, and of course it should be protected under privacy. Even if you made a disclosure to your telephone operator, so we should forget about third-party doctrine. But where do you go then? You drop third-party doctrine. Then where do you draw the line between private and public? I think that FCC came in with its order and saying, hey, when it comes to web browsing history, when it comes to the URLs that the users input, the users register with network operators, that is within privacy, and those sectoral approaches could accumulate into some sustainable line drawing between public and private. The problem with the right to be forgotten, the problem with the right to be forgotten, well, problem with the data protection based right to be forgotten is that it does not even attempt to do that line drawing. It does not even attempt to distinguish what is public and what is private and just leaves the line drawing to the subjective wishes of the people greedy about their reputation. So I think that there is a hope for global harmony. I don't think there has been really much discussion of how to draw where and how to draw the line, especially in this digital age where circulation of information is of much more consequence and of much higher speed. So if that discussion is somehow revived, maybe we can reach some, sustainable harmony.
Thank you. This is a great discussion in general. One point and then one question. When we hear about the right to be forgotten, it sounds like there's an event that is being forgotten. In other words, somebody's non-payment of taxes or somebody's commission of a crime or something like that, as opposed to simply minimizing attributes about a person that are available. I could imagine a context, for example, where a country that's come through a religious civil war might, as a matter of national policy, not want people's religions to be listed. Not an event, but a fundamental characteristic of somebody. And we have an employment I know we have interesting issues in employment about potential employers not being allowed to ask for resumes with photographs, because those photographs would reveal something about age, gender, race, and the like. Understanding what some of these tensions are and moving beyond just forgetting events, what are the best arguments that societies have for what facts should not be readily available? And what societal interests are there? I think I tend to hear all of this through the lens of, well, countries, various nations are concerned about the welfare of particular individuals. It's harmful to particular individuals. But what societies can, or what can societies argue are the broad societal interests, not just the aggregation of individual interests, in keeping certain information invisible or hard to find?
So I think there's one thing emerging in the case law in India and the recent case in Canada, and this relates to what KS was saying about suppression orders. We're seeing a wave of cases that are about court documents and whether people's names are redacted from court documents. And that one seems to me like a particularly compelling societal interest, because these are people who were seeking justice from their government, and the only way to get it was to agree to this, you know, a ruling that was going to have their name in it. And that's having the consequence of that be that your name is necessarily out there and easy to find. I can very readily see societies looking at that and saying, you know, that no, that shouldn't be a consequence. And the Well, I mean, Costejas came from a government-mandated statement, so it also goes somewhere in this category. But, you know, for example, in the Canadian case that just happened, a Canadian court decided that Canada's data protection law applied to a Romanian website and ordered this Romanian website to stop hosting content, and explicitly said one reason for this order is so you can take it to Google and get Google to delist the Romanian website. So this case has everything in it. But the starting point is that the Canadian courts publish these rulings, and they're hosted on some court websites and some like an LII website, but they use robots.txt so that they're not indexed. So the courts kind of struck this balance where that's similar to the balance that the Costeja court struck, where this information is available if you look on the court site, but we don't want it to be indexable so that it's the first thing you find when you search on people's names. And then the Romanian site took these rulings and put them on their site, made them indexable, and charged people money to take them down. So, I mean, what stands out in that case to me is this was a government document. This was something where the state, you know, our elected representatives and our judiciary decided what balance of public and private there should be in these government publications, and then it was taken out of their hands by sort of the internet. And I think it's kind of at the narrow end of what you might identify as a legitimate public interest, things that are government publications seem like that might be in there.
And also, to respond to your question head on, I think it is a fair assessment that right to be forgotten, at least the classical right to be forgotten, arises out of people's desire not to be unfairly discriminated for their past, for their shameful conduct, or conduct that are viewed by others as shameful. So, you know, classic cases of right to be forgotten are about, you know, reborn prostitute or victims of sexual abuse. And yes, there are facts that, there are facts upon disclosure create in the American terminology a clear and present danger of being discriminated against. So for instance, being viewed as a victim of sexual abuse in Africa
will mean just, you know, cycles of discrimination, you know, in all walks of that person's life, even if it's not something that, you know, he or she have chosen to be associated with. So I think that the classical right to be forgotten, I think it is a viable jurisprudence, where you look at, you know, how to control information so that that explosive information that may trigger discriminatory discriminatory attitude in other people, you know, so to combat discrimination. So, but the problem is if you try to enact the right to be forgotten with the data protection law, that's when the problem begins, because data protection law doesn't really talk about the potential for discrimination, doesn't talk about the interest, doesn't talk about you know, how likely it is, for instance, like whether Costea will be discriminated for having his house auctioned of, you know, 12 years ago. Talks more about how he's a successful businessman now, so that, you know, auction 12 years ago is no longer relevant, which generates more discrimination against a businessman who are no longer successful, right? So the same Costea who is not doing well now will not win that, will not win the same right to forgotten decision, because if he's not doing well, then, you know, what the auction 12 years ago will still be relevant to gauging, you know, his financial status now. So I think discrimination is definitely really important theme in figuring out more globally harmonized right to forgotten discussion.
Any other comments?
Hi, I'm Sukarn from SFLC.in, India. I'm a counsel there. So Indian cases have been brought up twice. I don't have a question, I just wanted to add on to it. In the recent case that is going on in a Delhi High Court in India, on 2nd February, the judge seemed to be leaning against allowing a right to be forgotten decision. This is a case where the petitioner had asked specifically, do we have a right to be forgotten? Google is also a party to this case. And the petitioner had asked for the entire case documents to be removed from search engines and court documents. The court here seems to be saying that, number one, court documents cannot be removed entirely because those are public records. Names can be removed, that's a different matter. And number two, the court said that you have approached the wrong court. We are not the court you should have come to. You should have gone to a lower court. So that's the direction it seems to be heading in right now. Thank you.
I think those cases are kind of cases like catching up with kind of a lack of privacy regulation in India, because if there were privacy regulations in India, then there could have been more kind of judicial discourse on suppression orders, where, you know, parties ask the names to be removed even from the beginning of the proceeding or, you know, by the end of the proceeding, but you know, instead of letting the parties do that in the very case that they want to be forgotten about, now they are kind of trying to revive the lost opportunity through those cases.
Yeah. And in India, this goes a step beyond this as well. We don't just lack such laws for data protection. We don't have any laws at all for data protection right now. So we are making some efforts for that in our country at the moment. Hopefully we'll have a data protection law soon.
I wanted to just add a couple of things to Andrew's question and to the question of the gentleman from R3D. On the subject of different countries having different balances of privacy and free expression, I completely agree with your point that no matter what you do, the other right will suffer, right? If you protect privacy strongly, free expression is going to suffer. If you protect free expression strongly, real people will get hurt in ways that would be recognized as privacy interests in other countries. And I think it's important for the jurisdiction question and for this pending case with the French DPA to recognize that where countries strike that balance is incredibly heterogeneous, even within the European Union. You know, under the Data Protection Directive and under the pending GDPR, it's expressly left to every individual member state to strike that balance for itself. And there is a there's a professor at Cambridge, David Erdos, who has released a bunch of amazing empirical research about the differences from one EU member state to another in how they interpret that. So the idea that where France struck that balance should be the answer for the whole world is problematic not just when you compare European to inter-American human rights frameworks. It's also problematic when you compare France to Sweden or to, you know, make comparisons within the EU. The other thing I would say to Andrew's question about you know, what are the legitimate times we might want to protect people's privacy interests or interests against discrimination or dignity interests, all of those are questions about harm. And that is what drives the tort system generally, the law of defamation or of privacy. We're asking, has someone been harmed by this? And this is part of what's so strange about using data protection as the framework, because data protection is driven by a concept of a fundamental right to control information about yourself that is in many ways independent of harm. And the Costeja ruling said that the success of a delisting request should not depend on whether the search result is prejudicial to the person. It sort of, it divorces the analysis from harm. In real life, a harm question, I think, inevitably creeps back in when anyone is trying to decide what to take down. But the sort of data protection framework doesn't tie to harms from discrimination or harms from, you know, intrusion upon very intimate subjects in a way that we're used to from the other frameworks that apply here.
My name is Julius Endert from Deutsche Welle in Germany. We are talking a lot about ISP and courts, but how should media itself behave in this context? Should they republish it, or should you said? So if this court decision is not on the Google index, but you can still send a hyperlink, for instance. Also, so my question is, how should media behave in this context?
Well, GDPR is pretty clear that activities for journalistic purposes are not, you know, subject to right to be forgotten or to the entire data protection regime. So, media, I think, should publish what you guys want to publish, yeah, without any consequences under data protection.
Just maybe just one last point, just to add to what has been discussed. I think depending on the case, when someone just wants to, I think removal should always be like the last resort. So if you can see other ways to remit, because you have to also hear that some people have legitimate claims when some information is wrong or out of context. So maybe one of the answers would be also in line with freedom of expression and access to information would to be, instead of removing that information, would be to add more information and to add context, to add or to correct something that was not well portrayed. So depending on the case, I think this would be more a right to response. So these should also be in play. That's why it's important to have this prior discussion before any removal of content, because sometimes this is not the best way to deal with the issue. Any more comments? I think we are, how much? Yeah, we are punctually done in time. Well, thank you all. Thank you very much for all this discussions and for the participation of you all. And please, if you want interested to hear more about or read more about the Brazilian Internet Bill of Rights and how it all began. And so there's a book here in English, and more information also in our website, itsrio.org. Thank you.